two places tonight. You need 1 Samuel 23, and you're going to need Psalm 63. 1 Samuel 23 and Psalm 63. You need both places. We're going to flip back and forth between the two and see what we can learn tonight from David. As I said this morning before you left, message about how do you survive? How do you survive? David is in the wilderness. We're talking about being in the wilderness spiritually tonight. How do you survive when you are in the wilderness? We'll learn some things from David. There are some times in our lives, figuratively speaking, that we would say, man, I'm on the mountaintop. I mean, life is good right now. Everything seems to be going well. We enjoy those times. But there's the other side of that coin. There are times when we feel as if we are in the wilderness, lost and bewildered, and we just don't have a clue as to what is going on. In our passage in 1 Samuel chapter 23, David is literally and physically in the wilderness. And as this chapter opens, King Saul is still on the hunt for David. He's organized, you might say, a manhunt. And the whole purpose of that manhunt is to find and kill David. So David is fleeing through the wilderness of Judah. He's being hunted like a wild animal. Look at 1 Samuel 23, verses 14 and 15. It says, and David abode in the wilderness in strongholds and remained in the mountain in the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul sought him every day, but God delivered him not into his hand. Now notice that in this time, this is not David's imagination running wild. We've seen David in the Psalms say that. We saw that, but he wasn't doing it. But now, this is God speaking, and this is what God says. Saul has sought David how many days? Every day. He's relentless. He says, but God delivered him not into his hand. And David saw that Saul was come out to seek his life, and David was in the wilderness as if in a wood. Now remember, Saul is not only the king of Israel, but he's also David's what? His father-in-law. See, some of you thought you had in-law troubles. But is your father-in-law hunting you every day, looking to kill you? See, you have something to be thankful for tonight. Amen? Or it's already better already. Now David, as we know, has been anointed as a new king of Israel, but he finds himself not on the throne. He finds himself on the run in the wilderness. And you would have thought that maybe after what he had learned, as we saw Wednesday night, that he would just go on up and take the throne. But God is not going to allow David just to waltz in up to the throne. David is going to continue to be tested to see what type of spiritual character he truly possessed. And being Floridians, and or being here in Florida, we can relate to the image in our mind of an orange. And you can relate to the process of peeling an orange and then maybe squeezing that orange to get what is on the inside out. Growing up, we had two big orange trees in the backyard. We had a tangerine tree. Something terrible happened to it. But anyways, but you could go out there and grab those oranges, peel them as a kid, and then we'd squeeze them, and then they invented something to go to work out of that. Remember that thing, that orange thing, the cylinder? And you could just take it, stab it right into the orange. Anybody remember those?
Oh, yeah.
Few of you, okay, all right. Don't call yourself cracker if you don't remember that, amen. I mean, that thing was, you didn't have to peel or anything, just stab it and get all the juice out of that. But, we digress. You peel that orange, you squeeze it, and you get what's on the inside out. And when you and I are in the wilderness, spiritually speaking, the wilderness brings what's on the inside out. It brings it to the surface. It shows what we are made of, spiritually speaking. And so we're going to see what David is made of, spiritually speaking, his character as he's being pressed and as he's being pursued. And there's King Saul, of course, and he was filled the spirit of Satan as he chased David and sought to destroy him. And Paul tells us in the New Testament that the same devil is our enemy today, and he seeks, just as Saul sought, he seeks to wage warfare against the believer, against those of us that know Christ as our Savior. What does Satan want to do when you and I are in the wilderness? Satan wants to discourage and destroy us during the wilderness times of our lives. So, spiritually we're in the wilderness. Spiritually you've got the devil who wants to discourage and destroy you. How do you and I to survive the wilderness times of trials and tribulations? from 1 Samuel 23 and Psalm 63. I think we can look at David's reaction at some things that are taking place in this chapter, and learn some very practical principles tonight that will help you and I when we are in the wilderness. So let's pray, and then we'll come back. And four things I want you to see tonight from this passage. Lord, we come before you again tonight, so thankful to be here. It is a beautiful day, a beautiful afternoon. It's a great evening to be in services. I pray that you reward our faithfulness tonight. Give us something from this passage. It'd be very beneficial to us this week, Lord, something we can draw from, meditate upon, Lord, and apply. We're thankful for the growth we have seen in the life of David. Take the opportunity to study his life and see these different stages and the trials and troubles and the mistakes that he's made, just as we made. But we're thankful, Lord, we too can learn as he has learned. We can recover as he's recovered. Help us be encouraged by that. But Lord, help us to see now how we can survive in the wilderness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, now David wrote Psalm 63 while he was in the wilderness of Judah. This is where he is in 1 Samuel 23. So the Psalm 63 was written while David is on the run here in Judah, running in the wilderness, running from mountain to mountain. And so in Psalm 63, let's look at a couple of verses to start off with tonight. Psalm 63, I want you to look at verse 1 and verse 8, and then we're going to flip back to 1 Samuel 23. So picture in your mind, just as we did Wednesday night with the Psalms we looked at in regards to chapter 22. David's on the run. He's in the wilderness of Judah. And while he's on the run, he's being hunted daily by King Saul. He writes this psalm. And so Psalm 63, verse 1 says, O God, thou art my God. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. Look at verse 8. My soul followeth hard after thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me. Now, that's exactly where we find David in 1 Samuel 23. Look at verses 1 through 4. Then they told David, saying, Behold, the Philistines fight against Keilah, and they rob the threshing floors. Therefore David inquired of the Lord, saying, Shall I go and smite these Philistines? And the Lord said to David, Go and smite the Philistines and save Keilah. And David's men said unto him, Behold, we be afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we come to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines? Then David inquired of the Lord yet again. And the Lord answered him and said, Arise, go down to Keilah, for I will deliver the Philistines into thy hand. And so what we saw in verse 1 and verse 8 of Psalm 63 is what David is doing in the first four verses. Notice that twice. In the first four verses, David inquires of the Lord. He makes requests. He seeks counsel from God. And he did that twice. This is what's amazing as we saw the turnaround on Wednesday night. Because prior to this, David hasn't prayed. David hasn't sought counsel. He hasn't inquired of the Lord. He's just been running in the arm of the strength of his flesh, making his own plans, his own schemes, his own decisions. And that's what got him in the mess and put him in the cave. But now David has learned. And so, from Wednesday night, we see where he hit rock bottom. We saw the change that took place in his life. And so now we find David, he's inquiring of God. He had the man of God, Gad, come, say, you need to get back up to Judah. He does. He's running around here. And now there's a call for help. And so he inquires of the Lord. And his men say, we're kind of nervous about this. So he inquires again. Now listen, one of the most important things you will ever do is to seek God diligently while you're in the wilderness of adverse circumstances. It's going to be one of the most difficult things you'll do. And not only that, but it's the most important thing you'll ever do. It's amazing. It seems like we get in the wilderness and we tend to want to run everywhere else, but to the one who can do something for us, and that's the Lord. It's the most important thing you'll ever do. Listen, it's tough to pray when you're bummed out. It's tough to pray when you're down and discouraged. But understand tonight, the Lord is our lifeline. Who else are you going to go to? Who else can do for you what the Lord can do for you? Remember what Saul said this morning to the Benjamites? Hey man, who can do for you like I can do for you? They should have said, well, God can do a whole lot more, Saul, than you could ever do. The Lord is our lifeline. He is our source of wisdom and discernment. Listen, when we're in the wilderness, when we're discouraged and down and out, we tend to make very bad and emotion-based decisions that don't tend to go well for us. Many people live their lives in emotional tyranny. And listen, that's not what God intended. God did not intend for your life to be dominated by your emotions. Amen. Well, that's a terrible way to live. Living life based on how you feel. Not what God intended. We're not to operate on our feelings. Oh, I just fell in love. I just fell out of love. I just fell in love with her. That's feelings. That's feelings. Up and down, in and out. That's why when you get married, it's that you, hey, you make a decision. I choose to love her every day until the Lord, till death do us part. Amen. It's a decision. There's going to be days that, hey, they ain't love me, daddy. Honeymoon's over. Reality kicks in. Amen. But I choose. I choose. David didn't want to, he didn't want to live this way. He was not going to be dominated by his emotions or his feelings. So he told the Lord, as we saw, he said, early, there in Psalms, he said, early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee. Now, you know, I have to ask this question. Do you? Do you seek him early? Do you long for him? Do you thirst for him? Is he your desire? Many times when we are in the wilderness, we run to all the wrong places for counsel. We make bad decisions, and then we just compound our problems. They just get worse and worse and worse. And David says, hey, I'm not going to do that. I've learned some lessons, and I'm not going to do that. I'm going to seek God. I'm going to thirst for God and what God wants. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, we made reference to this either Wednesday night or last Sunday. But the verses say this, and I'll highlight what I want you to hear. He says, for we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble, which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed. He says, we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we despaired of life. That's how difficult it was. He said, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves. That we, he says this though, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raiseth the dead. Paul used that word pressed there. Again, that reminds me of being squeezed. He said, hey, we've been squeezed. Hey, we even despair of life. The sense of death in ourselves. But we're not going to trust in ourselves. We're not trusting God. We're going to trust in God. See, David knew that only the Lord could refresh his dry and thirsty soul. Question is, are you going through the wilderness tonight? Are you in the wilderness? Well, now is not the time to forsake your communion with the Lord. Now is not the time to turn your back on the Lord. Now is the time to seek him more faithfully and diligently more than ever. In the wilderness, you've got to stay in communion with the Lord. Number two, when you're in the wilderness, how do you survive? You continue to do what is right. Continue to do what is right.
Well, I'll just tell you, things aren't going my way. That's just, it gives me reason to do wrong.
No, that's just your flesh. Continue to do what is right. Now, as we saw in verses 1 through 4, David heard that the people of Keilah, a city in the northern part of Judah, were in trouble. David inquired. David sought the Lord about what to do. And God said, go fight the Philistines. So what was David to do? Should he risk his own life to go and help these people? I mean, he's a hunted man. Now he's going to expose himself. He's going to come to a city. And he's going to come show up and help them fight the Philistines. You know, Saul's going to find out immediately and come looking for him. If he came out of hiding, he runs that risk of being found out. Now the right thing, no doubt, was for David to go and help his brothers in Keilah. And thankfully, David obeyed God's will. Look at verse 5. So David and his men, in 1 Samuel 23, David and his men went to Keilah and fought with the Philistines and brought away their cattle and smote them with a great slaughter. So David saved the inhabitants of Keilah. Now, let's understand that while David's doing this, just like you and I, while you might be doing something for somebody else, you still have your what? Your problems. You're still in the wilderness. David still has his situation, his own set of problems, yet he went and he helped those people as God had instructed him to do. Hey, we are to help other people. Hey, just because we're going through difficulty doesn't mean we shut down and quit doing what is right. Quit doing what the Lord expects us to do. When you're in the wilderness and discouraged, it's very easy to quit doing what you know is right. Lock yourself in your house and have a pity party. That's what Saul was having. No one cares for me, big baby, this morning. Not David. David said, hey, I'm going to do what's right. God said, go and fight, and go and fight. And Satan puts those types of thoughts in our mind. He'll say, listen, you obey God, and you do what's right, and you live for the Lord. Look, he'll say this, look where it's gotten you. Look where you are right now. You're in the wilderness with all these problems. If God loved you, you wouldn't be here. Remember, you're there for a reason, for a purpose, just as David was. Boy, the flesh will come in, the devil will come in, start whispering in your ear, start working on your conscience, and try to get you to do what is not right while you're in the wilderness. Satan loves, listen, he loves to discourage us and to get us to question God. He loves to do that. But we have to understand something about Satan. The Bible tells us in John chapter 8, verse 44, Satan's a big fat what? Liar. He's a liar. Listen, when we quit obeying God, again, all you're doing is compounding your problems. Now, I know you don't see it that way, but that's the way it is. You're just getting deeper and deeper in the hole. It isn't right to obey God only when circumstances are good. It's right to obey God all the time. Take your Bible, go to Galatians chapter 6 for just a minute. Galatians chapter 6. It is right to obey God all the time. Galatians chapter 6, look at verse 9. Galatians 6, verse 9. It's a verse we know, but I just wanted you to see it. Galatians 6 and verse 9 says this, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. You know, I was working on this message and looking at these different aspects. You know, sometimes you're going through the wilderness, and you don't really know you're going through the wilderness. Amen. You kind of look back and go, ooh, that was a rough patch. Well, that was a rough spot. I was thinking about when Leanne got sick and was diagnosed with MS back in 2009, and really for the next few years, it was a blur. It was just enough really for her to get out of bed and come to work and go back home and go to bed. That was it. And the boys were playing sports, and we were became favorites down at Subway and McDonald's, and that type of, it was just a very, but you say, what did you do during all that? We just kept doing what we were trying. You know what? And there were times, there were plenty of times she could have stayed home in bed. You know what? She came home. And you know she did because she sat right there and played game. Week after week, service after service. You know what? You obey God when things are good, and you obey God when things are tough. Hey, you do what's right when you're in the wilderness. You do what's right when things are tough. And the Lord will bless. Just get up as best you can and go and do. And she did, and that's what we're to do. And that's what David is doing. Hey, David is continuing to do what is right. David was in the wilderness, but he exclaimed, look back at Psalm 63. Look what he said in verses 3 and 4. In Psalm 63. Now remember, he's in the wilderness. He's on the run. Someone's trying to kill him. Every day, Saul and his army is looking for David. Look what he says in Psalm 63. Look at verses 3 and 4. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee as I'm hustling to the next hiding spot. Isn't that good? Because thy loving kindness is better than life. You said, what loving kindness? Well, he's still alive. Amen. Look at verse 4. Thus will I bless thee while I live. I will lift up my hands in thy name. He's in the wilderness, he's in the run, he's on the run, life is tough, he's away from family, his parents in Moab. But he says, I'll tell you what, even though life is difficult, I'm going to do what's right. And I'm going to tell you what part of doing what right is in the wilderness is praising God. So how can I praise God when all this, hey, you, because there's always something to praise God for. Always something to praise God for. And that's what you need to get focused on. Not what's wrong, but what's right, praise God. As he says, I will bless thee while I live, I lift up my hand. In thy name. David was determined that he would do what was right, even in the wilderness. It reminds me of Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8. Daniel's a teenager. He's been captured, taken by the Babylonians. He's taken back to Babylon. He's dressed like a Babylonian. He has the haircut of a Babylonian. But it says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. See, Daniel was determined, just as David was determined, he was knew what was right. Daniel purposed and was determined he would do what was right. Listen, that any of you been captured, taken to a foreign land? Okay. Daniel's in a wilderness. But you know what Daniel's going to do while he's there? He's going to do what's right. He could have said, hey, this isn't right. I was living for God. Look what he allowed happen to me. Taken from my family and all. Forget God. Bring on the wine. Give me a steak. He didn't do that. He said, I'm going to still do what is right. Number three, when you're in the wilderness, how do you survive? Keep your eyes on the Lord, not on people. Keep your eyes on the Lord, not on people. Now listen, if David was depending on people to encourage him to get him through this wilderness, he would have been in some serious trouble, as we'll see in just a minute. If he was focused on people, he would have had plenty of reason to give up. Now look at verse 3 of 1 Samuel 23. It says, and David's men said to him, behold, we be afraid here at Judah. How much more than if we come to Keilah against the armies of the Philistines? And so his core group of men try to discourage him. That's not a good idea. And so they try to discourage him. Now look at verse 7. Let's pick up the story. They've got a great victory for the inhabitants of Keilah. And it says, and it was told Saul that David was come to Keilah. And Saul said, God hath delivered him into my hand. But do you think God's doing anything for Saul? But he sure does sound religious, doesn't he? That's the way that goes. He says, for he is shut in by entering into a town that have gates and bars. Saul called all the people together to war, to go down to Keilah to besiege David and his men. And David knew that Saul secretly practiced mischief against him. And he said to Abiathar the priest, bring hither the ephod. Then said David, O Lord God of Israel, thy servant hath certainly heard that Saul seeketh to come to Keilah and destroy the city for my sake. Now look what he's, he rescued these people from the Philistines. Great slaughter, got stuff back. Look at verse 11. Will the men of Keilah deliver me up into his hand? Will Saul come down as thy servant hath heard? O Lord God of Israel, I beseech thee, tell thy servant. And the Lord said, he will come down. Then said David, will the men of Keilah deliver me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will deliver thee up. Whoa! But he risked his life to save them. And they're going to turn on him. He said, yeah, David, Saul's going to come, number one. And number two, they're going to give you up. They're going to turn you over to him. And then he's over in the wilderness of Ziph. Look over at verse 19. Verse 19. He's hiding there. Look what it says in verse 19. Then came up the Ziphites to Saul to Gibeah, saying, doth not David hide himself with us in the strongholds in the wood, in the hill of Hakilah, which is on the south of Jerusalem? Now therefore, O king, come down according to all the desire of thy soul to come down, and our part shall be deliver him into the king's hand. And so the people of Ziph betrayed David. Wow. It's a good thing David didn't have his eyes on who? On people, because they'd have let him down. Now there was a bright spot in David's life, and that was Jonathan. Look back at verse 15. And David saw that Saul was come out to seek his life. And David was in the wilderness of Ziph in a wood. And Jonathan, Saul's son, arose, went to David in the wood, and strengthened his hand in God. He said to him, fear not, for the hand of Saul my father shall not find thee. Thou shalt be king over Israel, and I shall be next unto thee. And that also Saul my father knoweth. And they two made a covenant before the Lord. David abode in the wood. And Jonathan went to his house. So Jonathan came out in the wilderness to do what? To encourage David and to remind him of God's promise. Now, what was the promise? David was going to be what? He was going to be king. Thank God for friends like this. If you've got a friend like that to encourage you in your downtime, your difficult time, thank you, Lord, for it. But listen, this is the kind of person we should be. When others are in the wilderness, we should be in Jonathan and encourage them. But here's the point of all this. When you look at people and focus on people, it's going to be hit and miss. It's going to be inconsistent. They'll let you down. Look, three groups of people, his own men, said, I don't think we should do this. The people he risked his life to save are going to betray him or turn him over. And then the people in Ziph said, hey, we know where he is, come and get him. We're going to turn him over to you. We're going to betray him to you. So what did David do with all of that? We'll look back at Psalm 63. What did David say? What were his thoughts on what was taking place in his life there in the wilderness? Look at verse 5. Psalm 63, verse 5. He says, my soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips. Are you kidding me? You're going to praise the Lord with joyful lips when three key groups in your life just made life difficult for you? But see, his focus is where? Not on people. It's on who? It's on the Lord. Look at verse 6. When I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches. Let me give you a translation to help you out here. How about this? He's simply saying this, Lord, I will be satisfied with you. How about you tonight? Can you be just satisfied with the Lord? Lord, I'll be satisfied with you. He said, hey, Lord, my mouth will praise you. He says, my heart will dwell and meditate on you. You know what happens? Is we let our heart meditate on the problem. We let our heart meditate on, why am I in the world? We meditate on the wrong things. Hey, listen, be satisfied with the Lord. Praise the Lord with your mouth and let your heart dwell and meditate on the Lord. David was determined to keep his eyes on the Lord. He was not going to keep his eyes on those three groups of people. He was not going to keep his eyes on his men. He was not going to keep his eyes on the people of Keilah. He was not going to keep his eyes on the people of Ziph. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 and 3 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And then it says this in verse 3, for considering, again, talking about Christ, that endured such contradiction of sinners, you and I, against himself, lest ye be weary and faint in your minds. We did that series years ago, Hook, Line, and Sinker. The battlefield is where? It's your mind. Lest you be weary in your mind. So if you lose the battle here, it's gone out here. You have to keep your... But David said, I will meditate on you in the night watches. I'm going to think because this is where the battle is won. And this is where the battle is lost. Lest you be weary and faint in your minds. How do we not faint? Consider him. Focus on the Lord. Consider Christ. Looking unto Christ, the author and finisher of our faith. And then our fourth thing tonight, how do you survive in the wilderness? Make the Lord your wilderness stronghold. Make the Lord your wilderness stronghold. Go back to 1 Samuel 23. This is an exciting chapter. We're going to come back and probably spend more time on this Wednesday night. But in this chapter, David is fleeing from one mountain stronghold to another mountain stronghold, and Saul keeps hunting him. Look at verse 24 of 1 Samuel 23. And they arose, it says in verse 24, and they arose and went to Ziph before Saul. But David and his men were in the wilderness of Maon in the plain on the south of Jeshimon. Saul also and his men went to seek him, and they told David, wherefore he came down into a rock and abode in the wilderness of Maon. And when Saul heard that, he pursued after David in the wilderness of Maon, just one place after another. And Saul went on this side of the mountain, and David and his men, on that side of the mountain. And David made haste to get away for fear of Saul, for Saul and his men compassed David and his men round about to take them. Whew. David's surrounded. He is surrounded. And Saul was finally about to close in on David and get the prize that he's been madly looking for. But God providentially steps in and takes care of David. Look at verse 27. But there came a man. Now listen, look at verse 26, man. Here's the mountain. Saul's over here. David's over here. David's like, oh, he's running over here. Oh, look at him. He's running over here. And Saul's over here. You ever played that game? You may have played that game. When we first got married, the first couple years, my wife used to say, you can't get me. And we had this dining room table. It's a coffee table thing. And she'd run around that, and I'd run around that, and I got sick of that. I just jumped over and called her, amen. And so, anyways, you're allowed to have fun when you're married, amen. And so this is going on. Now Saul's got him. He's got him. He's getting ready to step in. He's going to put the hammer on him. And then all of a sudden a messenger shows up in verse 27. But there came a messenger unto Saul saying, haste thee and come, for the Philistines have invaded the land. Wherefore Saul returned from pursuing after David and went against the Philistines. Therefore they call that place some long name. Okay. Now see? Just trust God. Well, look, it's easy to say, but David's doing it for us. Just trust God. David's doing what is right. He said he knows he's going to be the king. He knows he's anointed to be the next king. He's doing what God has said to do. Even though it looks terrible, even though he's on the run, even though things are looking desperate, you have to trust the Lord. Make the Lord your wilderness stronghold. And so the chapter ends with David in the stronghold there in Gedi. Look at verse 29. And David went up from thence and dwelt in strongholds at En Gedi. But do you know what David's stronghold was? You say, yeah, it was the rocks. Now, look at Psalm 63. Look what David says about this time in the wilderness. Psalm 63, look at verse 7. He says in verse 7 of Psalm 63, because thou hast been my help, I'm of the Lord. Therefore, in the shadow of thy wings will I rejoice. My soul followeth hard after thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me. Now in the Bible, that phrase, God's right hand, that's a symbol of God's mighty power, God's strength. See, David was trusting in the Lord. God Almighty was David's stronghold. When you and I, or when you are going through the wilderness, you need a stronghold that will not change. God's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You need a stronghold that will not change. You need a stronghold that will not crumble. God will never crumble. God's not going to fall under the pressure, okay? He's not going to collapse under the pressure. And so the only stronghold is Jesus Christ. Listen, in His written word, that's the stronghold for you and I as believers tonight. Jesus Christ and His written word. Abide and rest in Him and trust in His word. That goes back to this morning's message. Listen, if God said it, God's going to do it. Okay? It may not have taken place yet, but He's going to do it. And you have to trust in that. Abide and rest in Him and trust in His word. Do not, when you get in the wilderness, hey, when things aren't going the way you want them, do not turn to the bottle. Don't turn to drugs. Don't turn to fornication. Don't turn to filthy pleasure. Don't turn to bars and nightclubs and thinking that these things, these places, and the people involved in those things are going to be a stronghold for you. All they do is bring further bondage to you. Again, you're just digging a deeper hole. You're just compounding your problems when you turn to those things. They are not strongholds. They are not stable. They will collapse. They will crumble and they will change. But Jesus Christ will not, nor will the Word of God. So in closing, so what do? Turn to Christ. Make Him your stronghold. Turn to His Word. These are strongholds that will never fail. So how do we survive? That's how you survive. We see it in the life of David. We hear him giving God praise in Psalm 63. He's writing, he has written that psalm while he is out in the wilderness, while he's on the run, while Saul is looking for him, close encounters with death, but David is praising God. David said, hey, the Lord is my stronghold. So in closing, as we wrap up, how do you survive? Stay in close communion with the Lord. Not your best friend. Not Facebook. Some social media. Stay in close communion with the Lord. That's what David did. He inquired of the Lord twice. And then he inquired again, are these people going to give me up? Stay in close communion with the Lord. Continue to do what is right. Continue to do what is right. Hey, you do what's right when life is good. You do what is right when life is tough. Do what is right. Keep your eyes on the Lord, not on people. Listen, everybody at one time or another is going to let you down. Let's just go back and park here for a minute. Amen. None of us are perfect. Everybody lets everybody down. Sometimes intentionally, and a lot of times not intentionally. It's just the way it goes. But that wouldn't, you wouldn't be let down if you didn't have your eyes on people. We have to keep our eyes on the Lord. He'll never let you down. Never let you down. And then the fourth thing was, make the Lord your stronghold. Not your job. As much as we love our spouse is not our stronghold. Our family is not our stronghold. Our children are not our stronghold. Listen, the Lord is our stronghold. The Word of God is our stronghold. Trust in the Lord. Turn to His Word. You will come through the wilderness. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the time tonight. Thank you for the Word of God. Thank you for some very practical thoughts tonight. 1 Samuel 23, we'll dig in a little deeper Wednesday night, but I pray, Lord, that maybe someone here tonight's going through some tough times. Things aren't going according to plan. And in their mind, they would say, yeah, I'm in a difficult strait. I'm in a tough spot. Maybe tonight, as we looked at David, it's been encouraging. Didn't say it made it easy. It wasn't easy running from Saul. The hustle, the breathing, the sweating, the anxiety to take care of the men. Moving from here, moving from there. I mean, you got to imagine in your mind it was real. It was real. Think of him as he went in and they rescued the folks of Keilah. I mean, rescued them, saved their life, got the cattle, brought back what had been stolen from them from the threshing floor. And yet those people that he risked his life for, we're going to turn him over. We can't focus on people. We've got to focus on the Lord. We've got to see the reality of what's taking place in David's life and relate it to our life. And it said, listen, if David could survive with those four thoughts, then I can survive. Hey, the God that David serves is the same God I serve. His bowed and eyes closed, maybe here tonight as a pastor.